I just watched a DistroTube video called Vim Can Save You Hours of Work. In the video, Derek Taylor said,
"Everybody owes it to themselves to learn the Vim text editor. So today, I just wanted to give you some real-world examples of how Vim is much faster at getting work done than your traditional text editor."
After I watched the video, I totally agree that Vim is much faster at getting work done than your traditional text editor. That is, if the traditional text editor being referred to here is Notepad, then yes, you owe it to yourself to learn to improve your text editing efficiency by using a more advanced text editor, whatever it may be. So, that leaves us with the question, how does Vim compare to a more modern text editor like VS Code? And that's what I will try to answer in this video. In the DistroTube video, Derek shows a series of text editing tasks and demonstrates how each task can be done efficiently in Vim. This provides us with a great starting point. We'll go through each task and I will show how I would accomplish the same task using the standard VS Code features. By the way, this video is not meant to be a competition between the two editors where there's a winner and a loser. The only goal is to compare between these two editors and show the different approaches that they take to improve your efficiency when working with text files. Although I consider myself an ex-Vim user, I still find myself using Vim regularly, especially when I'm on a mobile device, and I learned several new useful Vim techniques from watching Vim videos, including this one. Learning Vim helped me to adopt an important mindset, that is to always strive to improve my own efficiency, and this mindset carries over to other editors as well. Now with that out of the way, let's move on to the first task. I'll be using the same file as Derek, which he has uploaded to his public GitLab repository. The first task is moving lines around. And here's DistroTube.
The most obvious way to move a line is simply to delete it and then go to the area where you want to then put it. So to delete a line, DD, right? And then navigate to wherever you want to put the line and then type P.
In VS Code, if you cut without first selecting any text, it will cut the whole line that you are currently on. Then when you pass, it will go above the cursor, like this.
For the most part, when you're moving a line, oftentimes you just want to swap the current line with the next line. All you need to know is that DDP, all one command, swaps the current line you're on with the next line. You see these two lines here? If I just want to swap those lines, just remember DDP just swaps the current line with the next line. You don't even have to think about it.
VS Code has dedicated commands for moving lines up and down, and using the hotkeys, you can move them like this. You can also select multiple lines and move them at once.
One of the cool things I've discovered with Vim is that you can quickly search for a string of text and find the line that contains that string of text and then move that line wherever it is you want in the document. So I'm going to do colon to get into command mode, and then I'm going to type slash ultimately, slash meaning search for the word ultimately, then I'm going to do another slash, and then I'm going to do M for move. I want to move it to the end of the document. Let's just do the dollar symbol. That means move it to the very end. And there you go.
One of the strengths of Vim is that you can perform a complex text editing operation in one go, using just a single command. I'm not sure, but I don't think you can do that in VS Code. What I would do instead is to search for the text, cut it, go to the end of file, and then paste it, swapping lines as needed. Later, Derek also showed a more complex Vim command that searches for some text, then move the line below the meshed line to somewhere above it. The flexibility and the power of these commands are quite fascinating to me. But for me in VS Code, I guess I'll have to do it manually.
By the way, cursor positions. I don't know if a lot of you guys know this, but to go back to the last cursor position that you were at, G semicolon. So if I do G semicolon right now, it goes back to that ESAC, that ending ESAC statement, because that's where my cursor was previous to that.
I never knew about this in Vim, so that's another thing I learned today. But I use this a lot in VS Code, which has to go back and go forward commands. It also works across multiple files, which could come in handy if you have to switch between multiple files a lot. Speaking about cursor positions, I've got one more tip to add. If you remember the name of a variable or function and want to jump directly to its definition, you can use the goToSymbol command. This feature requires language support from the editor or from extensions. Unfortunately, shell scripts don't have this feature by default in VS Code, but still, I think it's worth mentioning a bit.
Say I wanted to indent this line here, line 10, all the way down to the end of this array, line 43. I would type colon for command mode. I could do 10, 43. That's simply a range, lines 10 to 43, and then do the greater than sign. That's the right pointing chevron. Hit enter, and we just indented lines 10 through 43. You can see the lines before it were not indented. The lines after it were not indented. So that's a really easy way to indent a block of text.
Applying the same operation to multiple lines is another powerful feature of Vim. Again, I don't recall VS Code having the ability to do all these actions in one go. But one unrelated ability that I think is quite useful is the expand and shrink selection commands. And it works like this. Once I've made my selection, I hit the Tab key to indent the selected lines.
This is an array. An array in Bash scripting typically is something that's got parentheses, and then inside it, it's got a bunch of values that are wrapped in double quotes. And you can see that's exactly what is happening here. But if instead of having these array items as individual items, maybe I just want it to be all one item, which would mean I would need to get rid of all the double quotes except the very first one and the very last one. So it's really just one big item in the array. Now, how would you go about doing this? I would type Control V to get into visual block mode, and then just go down, selecting all the double quotes. I went too far, and then type D on the keyboard for delete. And all of the opening double quotes are now gone. Now I still have the ending double quotes to all of these lines. For me, I would probably use a macro for this. Q records a macro. I'm going to set it to 2. So you see at the bottom it says recording at 2. So everything I do from now on is a recorded macro. J to go down one line, the dollar symbol to go to the end of the line, X to delete the character at the end of the line, which is going to be double quotes. Q to finish recording that macro. And now I need to run that macro, but we need to know exactly how many times to run that macro. I want to run it from this line here all the way to this line here. So 11 to 42, that's 31, right? So let's do 31 at 2. And it ran that macro 31 times, and it removed all of those double quotes. Now that, me talking it through, you know, takes a little longer, but honestly, just doing it, I could have removed that beginning double quote and the ending double quote from all of those items in seconds. You know, like seriously, like 5 seconds, 10 seconds. It would have taken a couple of minutes to do that in your standard text editor.
Macros is another Vim feature that I miss sometimes. In VS Code, the only possible way to do this is to manually remove each quote one by one. Just kidding. One efficient way to do this is to use the column selection feature in VS Code. It lets you select a rectangular block of text and lets you perform editing operation simultaneously on each line. Back to the task, I would use the column selection mode to select the opening quotes and remove them. Then press the end key to go to the end of the line, then backspace to delete the ending quote. Finally, I remove the two extra quotes on the first and the last line.
Now let's imagine that this array started life looking like this, and we need to go back and actually add the double quotes at the beginning and at the end of each line, because that's a little trickier. How do you go about doing that? What we need to do again is to get into visual block mode. So do Control V, 30J, 30 down. I needed to go down one more, so let's J one more time. Select all of those lines. Then you need to get into command mode from here. So do a colon, norm, for normal mode, space, capital I. So it's going to get me into insert mode on all of the lines selected at the very beginning of the line. I want you to type double quote. And if I hit enter on that, we just added a double quote to all of those lines. Now we still need to go back and add the ending double quote.
For the ending double quotes, Derek did the same thing. Use the visual block mode, then run a normal mode command to add a double quote to the end of the line. Unfortunately, there's a little mistake, but thankfully, in Vim you don't have to redo it all over. You can just recall the previous command and fix it. I never knew that the norm command would let me apply normal mode operations on each line, and that's another cool Vim trick I learned today. If I were to do it in Vim, I would have used the find and replace command with a regular expression and then manually fixed the first and the last line myself. And now, here's how I would do it in VS Code. Again, I would use the column selection mode to select the lines needed. Then, I would press the N key to make the selection cover each line fully. Then, press the double quotes key to surround each selection with a pair of double quotes. And again, I would manually add the two missing quotes myself.
What if you want to change multiple words that you've searched for? Now, this is a really neat command. So searching, of course, is just doing a slash, and then I'm going to search for the word the. CGN means change the next search match. So change the next match of THE. So CGN, and you see where I was at on THE disappeared. I could type something new. Maybe I want to type THE all caps. Then I'm going to hit escape. And then I get to CGN again. I go to the next instance of the, and I could change that to THE escape. Now, if I wanted to do this multiple times, instead of doing CGN and then typing the word and escape every time, I could just type period on the keyboard. What is period? Period means repeat the last command I just did. So if I did period, and you see otherwise is now otherwise with THE capitalized. If I do period again, the next instance of the is all capitals, THE.
The CGN command is another one that I definitely have to take note of. And using the period key to repeat the last action is one more Vim feature that I really miss. But I think the multiple cursors feature in VS Code kind of make up for it to some extent. Here's how I'll do it. First, I search for the. I hit enter to skip the first match. Then escape to finish searching. I press Ctrl D several times to select more occurrences. Finally, I edit all of them simultaneously.
One other thing that can save you all kinds of time, if you're constantly typing the same things, you can set up abbreviations in Vim. For example, let me set up an abbreviation with colon AB for abbreviation, and I'm going to set this abbreviation, FSF, Free Software Foundation, with the correct capitalization. I'm going to hit enter on that. Now, let me just start typing something here. For example, the FSF was founded in 1985. The FSF web address is FSF, and then I'm going to do Control V, meaning don't expand this, .org. And you see, that time, it just keeps FSF as FSF. It didn't expand it.
Abbreviations are very useful in Vim, and I used it a lot. Meanwhile, in VS Code, you can define your own snippets file. Here I defined a snippet for the Free Software Foundation, and now whenever I type FSF, I can press tab afterwards to expand it. If I don't want FSF expanded, I just type it as usual, as I configured my VS Code to only expand snippets when pressing tab. You can also assign snippets to keyboard shortcuts, and it helps me write code much, much more efficiently.
The last thing I want to mention is running shell commands from within Vim. Where it really comes in handy, I found, is how many times have you opened a file in Vim and started editing it, and then you go to write it, and it complains, hey, this file is read-only because you don't have permissions to actually write that file. A lot of Vim users just have memorized to get around that read-only error. Just try colon W space exclamation sudo space T space percent sign.
Now, although VS Code has a built-in terminal, interfacing with shell commands isn't one of VS Code's strengths. But luckily, when you try to save a file and don't have the permission, VS Code will offer you an option to retry as sudo, so you don't have to remember any command. But when I tried it, I couldn't get it to work, unfortunately. In conclusion, different text editors provide different ways to help you be more effective at editing text. In many discussions, I've seen people put a lot of focus on Vim features or attributes that the other text editor doesn't have, without considering other features or attributes that it does have and may make up for its lack of Vim-specific feature. Biases like this make it easy to feel that your favorite text editor is superior than the other alternatives, when other editors may be just as powerful.
Eat your heart out, VS Code.
After all, people choose text editors for a wide range of reasons, and the context is diverse. So I think there's not much point in finding a single winner here, but I think it's more important to learn from each other, both about our favorite text editor and other choices. I admire people who are very efficient at their text editing skills, whatever editor they're using, especially Notepad. After all, the more tools I know how to use effectively, the more flexible and efficient I am. So let's know our options, learn about what each one has to offer, and see what we can bring into our own workflow. And that's all I have for this video. Thanks for watching.